Welcome to the 33rd episode of the Naina Redhu Experience. I'm doing one where I'm standing. I wanted to get a little more action into it because it's so cold. I'm already wearing like a jacket and a kind of a sweater and a thing around my neck. For those of you listening, just the audio, obviously you can't see what I'm wearing. That's not really relevant. I don't really talk about brands in these podcasts right now. This is the 33rd episode of the Naina Redhu Experience, and thank you very much once more for listening to all the other episodes. If you haven't listened to any of the other episodes, I mainly talk about photography, professionalism, blogging, and I prefer to answer questions that my readers send in. But sometimes, while I do get a bunch of questions, none of them are relevant to what I do or things that I would like to talk about. Sometimes I get questions where I feel like I'm an agony aunt, which I don't really mind. I sometimes think that we all have experiences to share, and that in my life there might have been things I have experienced that if I talk about, maybe someone will get something out of it. That might be a little pompous or arrogant to think of, but I listen to a lot of other podcasts. I listen to Joe Rogan, and his life is quite different from mine, but I find it inspiring to listen to what he has to say about where he's come from, how he progressed, how he's made his life what it is right now. His podcast is amazing. Sometimes it's just a bunch of jocks talking about nonsense, but it's not really nonsense. It's fun. I like listening to it. And his podcasts are really long. Most of them go on for about 3 hours. I don't think I'd be able to talk for 3 hours. I mean, I could, but constantly, maybe not. I think I would have to do breaks and then follow up. But I think in the Indian market right now, podcasting, it is catching up, but it's still not a mass thing where there are not too many people who are listening to podcasts. There aren't too many people who are looking at blogs either, because most of India's population is still living, not living in metro cities, and the consumption or the access to the internet currently, I think, is maximum in the metro cities. So I don't think there is a very large audience for podcasts right now, but it's a great way to connect with the existing audience that you have if you are a blogger or if you have a website or if you rely on the internet to do pretty much anything, whether it's you just have a hobby blog or if you are sharing your portfolio online. I think a podcast is a great way to experiment, to talk. I think you might even... if you're scared of, for example, public speaking, like I used to be, I no longer do, because once you've been on stage a bunch of times, you really don't care about people judging you, because people will judge you. It's what we do. But to be able to be on stage and present yourself as who you are, I think that doing a podcast might actually help you out in that. Today, in this episode, I thought about, I don't really have any audience questions per se for the podcast, but I do have this one question that I get asked quite a bit, like a lot. I'm a little embarrassed that I'm actually going to talk about it, because I don't look at it as a big deal. What I'm going to be talking about today is whenever I meet someone, if you have seen any of my photos online, if you have seen any of my blog posts where I'm posing, I'm wearing brands, or if you've seen any of my mugshots on any of the social media channels, you'll see my hair. Yeah. Whenever I go somewhere and I'm meeting someone for the first time in person or just the first time in general, invariably the question comes up, or someone wants to come and tell me that, oh, wow, your hair are awesome, or that's an interesting haircut, or... I've been dying to ask you, but like, what's the story behind those hair? Etc., etc. I even had about... I've had these hair for almost 2 years now. Most of my life I've had a short haircut, like a... You know, I don't know if you call it a boy cut. I don't know. But it's like a... I've even had a crew cut in college. So for most of my life I've had short hair. And I think the longest hair I had was when I got married the first time. So I had hair till like here, till my waist. But I don't know if you've actually seen the entire hair. It's like this. So, you know, this side is like this. And then there's this side and there's nothing here, and then, you know, in the back as well, there's nothing there. So basically you're just looking at this one thing at on the top. So there's nothing all around on this, on the scalp. It's just right at the top. So if it was really short, I could maybe make a mohawk out of it. And so yeah, I've had these hair for 2 years, and I get it a lot. I get these questions a lot, like, why these hair and what motivated you and what's the story behind this, and that's so cool. And about a year ago, I think a year ago, I got an email from someone who is a journalist at a newspaper or a magazine. I'm sorry, I don't remember who it was or what publication it was, but they were doing a story on you know, women and their hairstyles, and they were trying to connect the angle between women having hairstyles like these in a country like India, and they were trying to connect it with feminism maybe, or being a modern person living in India, for example. And they wanted to interview me and ask me why I did these hair. And honestly, I don't really, there's no meaning behind it. It's just hair. And I told them that I don't think I was the right person for their story because I didn't fit the profile at all. I didn't do it because I was, they were like, oh, what were you rebelling against? And what statement were you trying to make? And I was like, fuck, I'm not trying to make any statements. It's just hair. I was just trying to find a new hairstyle that worked for me, because the short hair works fine. I don't really mind the short hair I used to have before this. If you go way back into my blog, you'll be able to see some of the photos. I used to like that, which is why I've always had that. Then in my 20s, when I got married for the first time, I thought maybe I should grow my hair and try what that feels like. So I grew out my hair, and they were like really long, and they were a fucking pain to manage. As it is, I have like super thick hair, and then this long, and oh my God, it was just, it was incredibly hard to manage. But I think long hair is like the laziest way to have a hairstyle for men or for women. You don't have to go for a haircut. All you have to do is just shampoo and condition it if you've got decent hair. You don't have to do any kind of maintenance, really. I think shorter hairstyles are higher on maintenance. Trust me, this is. Because I need to do this trim thing like every 15 days if I wanted to look like this. What I basically do is I just go to the loo and I put my trimmer on 4 and I just go and I'm done. And then I remove the clipper cover, which is on 4, and I just use it bare to make these lines here. So this line is only here and it's on the right hand side. It's not there at the back. So for people who are just listening, I mean, you can't see the audio. So there's a line right where the shaved part of the hair connects with the long part of the hair. And that's where I just put the trimmer for like 5-6 millimeters and just shave it off completely. So it's a nice demarcation. It looks nice. And that's actually the hardest place to shave, to use the trimmer. So if you keep that short, so when it grows back again, then it's easier to trim if it's already short. So that is actually, it's really a practical consideration. There is no, I'm not rebelling. It's just really, really easy to manage. And just 2 days ago, we met somebody at an event. We were meeting for the first time. And they came up to me halfway through the event. They were the hosts. And they were like, I really have to, again, I don't remember exactly what they said, but they were like, I really have to ask you, what's the story behind this hair? And Bharat was sitting right next to me. Bharat is the guy I call the boy. Whenever you see me mentioning the boy, that's him. He's my husband. And she said, oh, but you know, it's so cool to have, see someone with such a supportive husband. And in my head, I'm like, what the fuck does he have to do with my hair? It's my hair. What do you mean by supportive? Like, he's got nothing to do with it. This is my hair. What does a husband have to do with it? So I had similar questions earlier also as a photographer, whenever I used to go out and I was on assignment and people would be like, I would have like random strangers of all ages and genders walk up to me and go, oh, you know, it's so cool to see a woman photographer. It's quite nice that in this day and age, families are willing to support their girls. And I'm like, fuck you. Just because your experience or your exposure doesn't allow you to believe that there is a different way of living doesn't mean you can just walk up to a stranger and tell them, oh, you have such a supportive family. Well, fuck yeah, I have a supportive family, but not because, you know, I had to make them supportive. They would have been supportive regardless of what I did. They're my family. They don't have a choice. You know what I mean? So this hair keeps getting asked about ki aise kyun hai, what was the idea behind it, you know, it's so cool. It's I don't know, maybe it is cool, it suits me, it makes me look thinner, my face doesn't, you know, when I have water retention and bloating, it doesn't have to, it doesn't give me that feeling of poof. So I like this, and it's so easy to, you know, I don't have to worry about, should I tie it up if I have to go to an event, do I get a blow dry, do I have to get curls, do I have to style my hair, I just shampoo it, condition it, and out the door. I don't have to think about it. I don't have to go to a salon. I tried going to a salon just last week where I thought maybe I should just, you know, because I can go to a barber who does it for guys and I just have to say, bhaiya, trimmer, please put your trimmer on this setting and just trim it off. The guy was so scared. I don't know what he did. And he started doing it with his scissors and I'm like, boss, you have a trimmer, just use the goddamn thing. And he's like, nahi, usse hoga nahi. Because I don't know, I think he was really scared because maybe women don't really come up to him and go and say ki ye trim kar do. I had to eventually come back home and do it myself. He charged me $150 for God knows what he did, but I still had to come back home and do it myself anyway. So it's no, I'm not trying to make a statement. I am just, it's just hair on your head and it grows and then you cut it. And if you don't like it, you shave your head. If you want, it grows back. Trust me, I've shaved my head like, I don't know, 4-5 times now, like completely. I still have hair right here, but I have done it where there was no hair on my head. I have shaved that. I have a photo of me with my dad, like I'm posing, his head is right above mine and he's shaved his head and I've shaved my head. And that's one of my favorite photos with my dad because it's cute, I think. We look like two eggheads. But there is no statement really. Would you ever ask a guy this? I mean, I'm not trying to get into the whole gender thing here, but you would never ask a guy, right? Like, what statement are you trying to make? Although actually, maybe you know what? You would. 5 years ago, if you saw a guy with really long hair, someone like my dad would probably ask him, you know, what are you trying to do with these hair? What are you trying to rebel against? Yeah, sure, okay. So maybe it's not really even a gender thing. But yeah, it's just, I like these hair. I even had a bit of a dandruff problem in the middle. So I thought that if I shaved it off from here, then I'd be able to manage it better, which has failed, by the way. The dandruff problem stays. It hasn't been affected by using a trimmer. I am trying out a new shampoo. It's called Tea Gel by Neutrogena. And I think that might work. I don't know, I just started using it. But I have to use very little shampoo. You know, that's one of the advantages. I have to use very little conditioner. My bottles don't finish so quickly. And my hair doesn't get oily as fast. So there are a lot of practical things why this stays. I mean, I've had it for 2 years. And recently, I have been thinking about maybe growing it back. Or maybe trying longer hair. But shorter hair and hair like these, they make me look younger. You should go back and see photos of me from 3 years ago when I had slightly longer hair. And then look at me now. I look considerably younger. Of course, I also lost 12 kgs 2 years ago. So there is that. Weight loss and looking, being fit kind of makes you look younger anyway. But you combine that with a haircut like this. Because there's shorter hair. So your face looks thinner. It makes you, because of the way we are conditioned, you don't expect older women to have what are thought to be edgy hairstyles. So you automatically assume in the first instant that this must be someone who's young. I am young. I'm not like, you know, I would like to think I'm still young. I'm 36 years old. I know women who have hair like these who are older than me. And no, we are not lesbians. So there is no statement. It's just hair. If you like it, thank you. I like it when you come and tell me, oh, hey, you know what? Cool hair. But no, don't involve my family or my husband. And no one has anything to do with these hair except me. What happened was, I was itching to try a new hairstyle and I had shaved my head a couple of times earlier when I was considering that, and I wasn't happy with a completely shaved head because it makes me look chubby. So I was looking for a new hairstyle to try, and I had been hearing a lot and seeing a lot about this thing called a buzz cut. I didn't really know what it was, but this is kind of what it is. But usually what happens is people shave maybe about 5 inches and then that's it. I've shaved the entire, except the top part of my scalp, I've shaved the entire sides. So a buzz cut is only you shave one side, maybe 3-4 inches of hair, 3-4 square inches of your hair, and that's it. And the rest of it, you leave it. So I was looking for that. And so I'm on Pinterest also, of course. And on Pinterest, I was browsing through models, photographs of models. I don't really remember why, but I spotted this photograph of a guy who had it was like a mohawk, So everything was shaved on the side, and in the middle he had left these hair, and they were quite long. But the way they had styled it and photographed the model was that they'd made like a nice big mohawk out of it. So the hair were a little longish. So I thought that would be something cool to do. And so I did it. I just shaved. First I shaved the left side, and I thought, maybe let me shave the right side as well. So I shaved the right side, and I was like, I don't really want a mohawk per se. So I decided to shave the back side of the head as well. And when I looked in the mirror, I kind of liked what I saw. And initially what I had done was I had completely shaved the sides. Now I trim it at 4 millimeter, but I had shaved it completely, which I didn't really like. It looked too, it was too stark. It wasn't, that looked even more like I was zabardasti trying to make a statement. So I did, I honestly didn't consider all this, that, oh my God, what are people going to say? And it's, no, I just really like it. It's cool. I really don't have to do a lot of management. And the problem is, winters may it's cold. It feels cold because, you know, it's your head. So I have to wear a hat, especially when I'm indoors or if I'm outdoors and it's windy and there's no sun. But no, there is no statement. I don't want to make a statement. I really don't care about statements as such. I'm too busy talking about professionalism and photography and the state of our industry. And I don't like to, you know, the time for making statements or rebelling was when I was probably in my late teens or in my early 20s. That's done. I've got things to do now. I really don't want to hold a, I'm not an activist. There are people who are activists. I am not an activist. My tools for communication or talking about what I believe in are my blog, my social media, and of course this podcast, which you can also call a video podcast. Or if you're just listening to the audio, then it's just a podcast. But I'm not trying to make a statement with the clothes that I wear or the styles of the clothes that I wear. The statement I want to make with the clothes that I wear and the things that I talk about is sustainability. It should not, you know, I don't wear fast fashion, for example. I recommend you don't wear it either. I want to wear locally made stuff. So if I'm in India, I'd like to wear made in India. Or if I'm going to traveling to America, then I would like to purchase made in America. If I'm traveling in Thailand, I'd like to purchase made in Thailand. Thai brands made in Thailand, because there's a lot of fast fashion that gets made in Thailand as well. So I want to make statements like those, that I want to support other people doing work that helps them earn a living. I don't support sweatshops. I don't support fast fashion brands. I like promoting you know, things made by hand, although I have nothing against things made by machines either. I mean, most, there's a lot of stuff that I wear that is made by machines, and I have no issues with that. But there's a bit of a line that you need to draw about things like these. A lot of people have told me that, you know, there are all these brands who do all this work and they have so much money to pay, and what's your problem? You're just running a blog and you just have to be a photographer, etc. blogger. But it doesn't sit well with me. I don't really know what reasoning I can provide beyond that. I'm not comfortable promoting fast fashion, for example. So yeah, statements like that I'm okay with making, but instead of just making a statement or presenting the visuals to support a statement, I'd rather shop and support by, you know, getting money out from my pocket and spending it with labels, brands, and people that I would like to support. So it's not something that I'm not the kind of person who's going to be standing at the top of a rooftop and going, you should do this, this is the best thing to do. I'd rather be doing it than screaming about it. I do talk about a lot of issues on my blog and on Twitter, and a lot of people come and tell me, oh, Naina, calm down. And my reaction always like, who are you? Again, mostly because it's always strangers who come and say that, people who know me, that I am kind of calm. I do talk a lot and I get enthusiastic, etc. But I get passionate. But yeah, please don't ever tell anybody to calm down and relax on Twitter, especially if you don't know who they are. It's irritating because you don't have context. And you know, generally, for example, when I talk on Twitter, I say things like, oh, but, you know, why do people do this? Why do people send emails like this? How are you dealing with problems like these? How have you dealt with unprofessionalism in your career? You deal with so many people. How do you do that? I'm genuinely asking a question. So if you have an answer to that question, please share it with me, because I genuinely want to know how all of you who are way senior than me or my peers, how the hell do you guys deal with this kind of shit? So I want to know that. But don't come and tell me, Naina, calm down. I'm probably going to block you, because I don't have time for this kind of stuff. I want to learn. I'm here to learn. I do this podcast because while I'm talking, there are some times where I learn as well. I'm probably one of the weirdest people who does videos, because I sometimes actually listen to my own podcast, because I think all of us need reminding. And sometimes when I'm formulating what I have to say, like, these are totally unscripted. There's no script. Sometimes I make notes, especially when there's a reader who's asked me a question, because I think it helps to have all these ideas and speak about those specifically. But podcasts like these, the one that I'm doing today, when I'm talking about my hair and how I'm not trying to make a statement, it's not scripted at all. The only times you'll probably hear there'll be a bit of a discontinuity in the video is if the bell rings, because I'm currently the only one who's at home, or if there's a really loud sound, then I might go back and do a sentence, which also I hate doing. I'd much rather leave it in. I was also thinking about this whole podcasting business, and first of all, I realized yesterday that there's no way to really figure out how many subscribers your podcast has or how many listeners you have on your podcast, which is an interesting problem. And I tried to do a lot of research around it, and one of the ways to figure out how many people, for example, are downloading your files or accessing it is, there is a service called PodTrack. That's PodTrac. It's free, and you have to basically register yourself there, and then you have to add a prefix to your MP3 files. So I upload my podcast MP3 files on my self-hosted WordPress blog. So I've just added that name, that link in front of the MP3 file. And that would help where PodTrack will come to know when the file has been accessed. So that's one thing. And the other way to do it is that in Google Analytics, you can define an event where you can ask Google to track if an MP3 file has been downloaded from your blog. And then you will get those statistics. Currently, whatever anyone downloads from my blog, I don't know what the statistics are because I haven't done that. But I just did that. There is a plugin that does that. It's called the Google Analytics Dashboard in WordPress. It's a WordPress plugin. And there is an option there where you can check and say track events also for these kind of files, and you can define what the file extensions are there. I have done that, but I still don't know how I'm going to see those numbers. I think I have to go to Google Analytics and look under events, but I just activated it last night. No, wait, last week. I activated it last week. And I am guessing after I upload this podcast, I'll get an idea of how it actually works. Or if someone goes back to one of my previous episodes and downloads a file. Because right now you can listen to this on YouTube. So their YouTube video views are there, and you can make out how many people have actually come to the page. They might not have listened to it completely, but it gives you a kind of a vague idea. So there's YouTube. You can look at it at the video on YouTube. You can look at it on my blog. And you can download the MP3 file directly from the blog. Or if you're on iTunes, you can also subscribe to the podcast via iTunes. And you can also subscribe via FeedBurner, which is where the RSS file is, which also feeds iTunes. So it all basically comes back to the files that are uploaded on my blog. But it's an interesting space. I think I am quite excited about podcasts. And I don't really listen to any Indian podcasts right now. I do want to change that. But I don't think there is any other photographer in India who's doing a podcast right now, or a blogger in the lifestyle photography space. If someone is doing a podcast, please let me know. I think I'd be interested in hearing what they have to say and the kind of things that they talk about. I'm not interested in lifestyle bloggers talking about beauty products and fashion and doing daily vlogs. I don't have the time for that kind of thing. And I know some really awesome bloggers who are doing that right now, and they have like insane numbers of followers on YouTube, etc., which is fine. They found their niche. They know what they do best. They enjoy doing that. I don't. I have thought about doing it, you know, makeup and putting like, oh, this lipstick and this. And I do enjoy makeup. I love makeup. But I don't know if I'll do that. Maybe I will at some point, just to experiment with it. But yeah, I am interested in listening to podcasts where I learn something. So I currently listen to Joe Rogan. I also subscribed last week to Christopher Ryan's Tangentially Speaking. His book called Sex at Dawn is the first book I heard on audio, which him and his partner read out. And I was immediately converted to listening to audiobooks. So that's the first audiobook I listened to, Sex at Dawn. If you are interested in anthropology, a little bit of history and philosophy related to how human beings have evolved and how we used to be tribes earlier and how we are now and how things have changed, you must listen to or read that book if you can. It's called Sex at Dawn by Christopher Ryan. His podcast is called Tangentially Speaking. I still haven't heard it, but I've just subscribed to it so I can access all the older episodes as well. But otherwise, yeah, Joe Rogan is my go-to guy for all my podcasts. Radiolab is good as well, but I usually have trouble deciding which ones to listen to because I can't listen to all of them. Like even with Joe, he does these fight companions where there is a UFC championship and then he'll get together with 2-3 of his friends and they talk about it. I don't really listen to that because I'm not into UFC. Sometimes I do listen to it. I try to listen to it, but it's not for me. So it's that way. I think podcasts are quite interesting. You can skip a few. You can listen to all of them if you want, which is why I think it's important to have some sort of a blurb at the beginning of the podcast or at the description, which tells you what the podcast is about. But mine, I'm trying to keep limited to about 30 minutes. For example, right now we are on minute 26 and I don't really want to do very long podcasts. If I do decide to do that, I will probably have to keep it scripted and probably talk about a subject in detail, which means I'll have to do a lot of research, which right now I don't really have the time for. But daily things that trouble us or things that we think about, like I've spoken a bunch of times about professionalism and how you can ask for 100% advance payment if you are a solo entrepreneur. I don't like using the word freelancer. You should not either. Call yourself a sole proprietorship. You can call yourself a solo entrepreneur. You can call yourself an independent contractor. Don't call yourself a freelancer. So I talk a lot about these kind of issues and professionalism in general, the blogging industry in India. I have been thinking about talking about photography as well, but I think value in the photography thing might be more if I do a proper workshop, like a small workshop with maybe 10 people who've paid to be there. And before we do the workshop, once they sign up, I ask them for their questions. I accept 10 to 15 photos from whatever they've shot so far and do like maybe a portfolio review, more from a real world standpoint than just the artistic standpoint. Because I think art is subjective, so I'm not going to look at a photo and say, oh, this is beautiful and this is art and this is not art. I think I'm more interested in talking about what would work for a client from a client's point of view. Some sample briefs, for example, if you go to a client and they tell you this is the kind of brief we're looking for, so what kind of images you need to produce. And the problem is the kind of photography I do is not, it doesn't fit in the very traditional mode of, you know, if you're an advertising photographer or you're an automobile photographer or you're a fashion photographer or you're a beauty photographer. I'm a narrative photographer and it doesn't matter what vertical it is. I shoot across the horizontal. So it's, again, this is something new in the industry as well. So a lot of clients have a bit of trouble wrapping their heads around what exactly I do. So I don't think there is a very large market for it right now, but there will be. Because this is the way to go. It's become open. Anyone can be a photographer. Anyone with a camera in their hands is a photographer. So I think it is more important to develop a skill where you can curate and tell a story from start to finish. Documentary photography has existed for a very long time. Even photo stories, especially abroad, are a very big deal, especially when it comes to photojournalists. But even if you're not a photojournalist, if you are working with a brand, the idea behind the kind of photography I do is to build the brand in a way to tell the story of the brand, you know. So when you have to do that, then you have to understand what kind of images fit together. You have to think about what the brand is, what is happening, and then to stitch from A to B and to create that narrative which makes sense to the viewer. So the biggest compliment I feel that I get for my work is when someone on the internet looks at my looks at a particular blog story or a set of images and tells me that they feel like they were there. That's my gold standard right there. And I think that's where the kind of photography that I do comes in. And I think photography in that sense is going to grow in future. There are going to be more photographers who want to do this kind of work and clients who want this kind of work, because this is hard. Brand building is hard. So if you are able to provide visuals and a connected story from A to B, then I think that is of immense value for a brand, and you don't just have to rely on advertising that doesn't look real anymore. So I think I want to do a workshop around that. I'm not sure if the subject kind of fits into a podcast format. There are some people who've written to me who say you want to know what camera settings to use. And honestly, for the life of me, I don't know what that means. What do you mean by camera settings? Shoot kya karna hai? What do you want to shoot? You need to know that first. And then you work backwards. And everything is available on the internet. I mean, I understand you have a different kind of input when you are talking to somebody and they're telling you, in person, how to make a particular picture. That can be done. But again, on this podcast, if I try to do that, I'll have to do screencasting where I'll have to show you a screen grab. I'll have to show you the back of my camera. I'll have to show you a before and after. And that just sounds really tedious. Right now, maybe I might do once in a month if I'm able to produce it like that. But right now, my equipment is quite simple. I have a phone which is on selfie video mode, which records the videos. I record it on Google Pixel. My laptop is on with Adobe Audition, which is recording audio separately as well. It records, the phone obviously also records audio. And I have a mic with a pop filter in front, which is recording audio separately, which I can then edit in Adobe Audition. That's the extent of my, setup for recording this podcast. I do edit the video file and add some filters on it, etc. And I clear out the sound from the audio, the noise from the audio, ambience noise. And I use, Adobe Audition to edit the audio. Video I edit in Adobe Premiere Pro. So, as you can tell, I'm a Adobe junkie. Photos I edit in Lightroom. And I use the VSCO film filters presets all the time. Like, I have some of my favorites which I use, but those are also, I don't use as is out of the box. There's a lot of tweaking I do: contrast, highlights, shadows, clarity, sharpness, etc., etc. So it really depends on each image. But yeah, I use Adobe software, and I have a very minimal setup for the podcast. Also, you might have gotten a bit of a break there. Apparently, the Google Pixel doesn't record video more than 4 GB. So it just showed me a thing saying 4 GB limit reached. In any case, I think this has gone longer than my usual 30-minute podcast episodes. So let me know what you think. If you want to hear something about photography, how I do it, or if you have specific questions related to photography, I can try and answer them in the next episode or any other episode. You can always send me questions on Twitter. I'm @NAINA, @NAINA. That's my handle on Twitter. You can also leave comments on the blog, which is naina.co. You can leave comments on my YouTube channel under these videos. And you can email me. My email is n@naina.co, n@naina.co. And I'll be more than happy to answer your questions, and they could be about anything, including life in general, relationships. I mean, I can talk about my experiences. You might see something there of importance, or it might pique your interest, or you might be curious about something else. It might lead to another question. And of course, I can anyways talk about professionalism, blogging, photography, podcasting. I've just started it, so I can share whatever I've learned, etc. So yeah, thank you for listening to the 33rd episode of the Naina Redhu Experience, and I hope to do this regularly. Thank you so much. Bye.